And of course, masculinity is often studied like as an object, not an object, you know, like just like studied, but then how masculinity sort of figures in our own, you know, like research encounters. So I want to talk about both aspects. And I want to talk about it with regard to my own experience of doing field work in the Caribbean island of Trinidad. So basically, I'm taking the focus from the Asia Pacific to the Caribbean islands. So what happened was, I will start with like, you know, a simple story about what I did. So I went to Trinidad and I stayed there for about 9 months, trying to understand race relations and masculinity. And so when I first went there, I mean, for those of you who are not familiar, so Trinidad had like two dominant ethnic groups, the Africans and the Indians. So Africans were taken as slaves, and after the abolition of slavery, Indians were, you know, taken as indentured laborers. So I was based in that particular island, so when I first went, and I tried to be connected with the University of the West Indies, so I went to the library and you know, wanted to get a library card. So the librarian sitting was really surprised to know that I was from Bangladesh. And so there was a moment of pause, and then the first thing he says is, oh, here is a bright boy from Bangladesh. So I was a little bit confused about what he was trying to refer to, you know, I mean, as a bright boy from Bangladesh. So later I realized that the largest slum in Trinidad is called Bangladesh. So here is this interesting bit about, you know, how sort of people from the Global South doing research in another Global Southern context, you know, are sort of constructed. So, that was one of the, you know, the starting, you know, sort of the context of the race. And I was also embedded in a cricket club for the whole time I was there. And the environment in the club was actually, what I can say, hypersexual. So the actors were very, very interested in engaging in various kinds of sexual activities. So as a member of the club, or as somebody trying to befriend the athletes, there was this expectation that I would also engage in all kinds of sexual activities that they were engaging in. But the whole time I was based in that island, I adopted the position of a celibate, so I abstained from all kinds of sexual activities. So what happened as a consequence was that, even though the athletes felt that, you know, I was, you know, I mean, because the, I have to provide a little information here. So this cricketing club that I was based at was dominated by the Indo-Caribbeans. So they felt that because of my perceived Indianness, they assumed that I was also, you know, one of them. So it was easy for me to basically, you know, to sort of be accepted into the cricketing fraternities of the Indo-Caribbeans. But my disinclination to engage in various kinds of sexual activities sort of made them question my belonging, you know, to the club. So it became a collective issue, you know, I mean, towards the end. So they wanted to make sure that I was engaging in some kind of sexual activities. So they thought that, well, maybe then I'm not interested in the kind of, you know, sexual opportunities that were available. So then they started, you know, asking if I wanted to have sex with men, if I wanted to have, you know, all sorts of other kinds of possibilities. And so the point here is that, so throughout my fieldwork, I sort of failed to perform the normative or the heterosexual masculinity as it was expected of me. So there were like multiple failures, if I can sort of describe it as some sort of failure. One on account of, you know, the fact that I come from a particular country which is perceived to be backward, you know, and therefore, you know, people from that country were sort of racialized in a very particular, in a negative way. And also there was this question of my not being able to perform, you know, a particular kind of heterosexual masculinity that was expected of me, even though I was studying, sort of, or trying to study masculinities in that particular setting. So the question I want to bring to the table here is that, so I sort of look at it as sort of failure, but not really like failure in the traditional sense, but more like productive failures. Because it was precisely because of my inability or a disinclination to sort of perform a particular kind of heterosexual masculinity that I was able to sort of see things that I would have otherwise not seen. So the different way they reacted in response to, you know, my not wanting to conform to their expectations actually led me to sort of, you know, understand the politics of gender, you know, configurations of patriarchy, and so on and so forth. So, you know, I mean, so these are some of the issues that I think are never really sort of given systematic attention. There is a tendency to not sort of highlight the kind of, you know, inadequacies of masculinities of the ethnographers or the social scientists. Because the idea is that if you talk about those failures, your research might be considered to be, you know, so it sort of, it might, your professional credentials may be questioned. People might think that, well, you're not really a good researcher, and therefore, you know, so actually, what I'm trying to say is actually the other way around, actually. So I think that, you know, precisely because that I didn't perform, you know, or I wasn't really from any of the, you know, the lower northern sort of settings, actually helped me sort of understand particular, you know, the dynamics of gender and sexuality in ways that I wouldn't have otherwise been able to sort of, you know, see. So basically these are the two important things, like gender, sexuality and race, and how they're sort of entwined in the production of the researcher's own subjectivity, you know. So I think this is where I would end, because I have only 10 minutes, but I want to be able to engage a few more questions, you know, and how we can sort of maybe, you know, unpack more.
So we have time for some questions before we go for lunch. Any questions or comments?
I think it would be.
Could you speak louder so we can hear?
Sorry, just so, can you hear me?
Adnan, can you hear?
Yeah, I can hear actually.
Okay.
I think I should assist you with providing more of a context in terms of masculinity in Trinidad and Tobago. In terms of the construction of masculinity, just to give a better idea of what he's saying, the research on masculinity in Trinidad and Tobago at the University of the West Indies.
I think several things would have happened in his context, just to try to contextualize what he's saying in terms of the advances to engage in sexual relation. Basically, what was happening in the Trinidadian context is he was assumed to be effeminate. So based on his being of Indian from Bangladesh and in Trinidad, Indo-Trinidadian males who are considered effeminate associate with him. So what happens in the context, basically, Indo-Trinidadian male who are not open to come out with their sexuality, they marry women and live heterosexual lives. So basically what seems to have happened to him is that he was identified as one of them. So basically they were inviting him into a space to let him know it's okay. We understand, we identify. So it's a case where he was identified as a homosexual by the males who are undercover in the context. So basically, I don't think he realized the space he ended up in Trinidad and Tobago. So basically, the advances to engage in sexual activity was them telling him it's okay to be gay. And we understand and we identify, you're not being judged by it. And basically, the area where he's saying he's from in Bangladesh, it's an area in Trinidad where homosexual Indo-Trinidadian male go to be able to practice homosexuality. So basically, he ended up in a lot of queer cultural spaces without realizing. So they were basically trying to make him feel comfortable and at home.
Kind of practices. So I think there is this reading there, but the dominant masculinity in the
much, Adnan. I think one of the reasons I had really wanted Adnan to speak is because often when, in a lot of research and our work on gender in the field, a lot of it has been done in relation to men doing research in relation to women and the tensions that that can produce. But I think it's also really important to consider when men are doing research on men in whatever aspect, like how masculinity plays out in that, and when that becomes a cross-cultural experience, for example, as was for Adnan in the Trinidad context, and like Daniel pointed out, that this can create other kinds of dynamics and spaces that we fall into are not based on our interpretation. And so therefore, the specifics, the context, the history, I think, are really important in engaging with in this research on masculinity. And that's why we've been saying we need to do more work on masculinities research in the Pacific specifically, and within Pacific context from Pacific scholars. So I'm going to, Adnan, thank you so much for being here so late into the night. I think it's past 3 a.m. for him. So we really, really appreciate it. And like I told you, I'll update you on the outcomes of the event and be in touch soon. Thank you again. Sorry for all the technical problems.
No, thank you.